Thank you so much for joining me again. This time I'm reading a story called The Christmas Eve Tree by Delia Huddy, illustrated by Emily Sutton. A forest of Christmas trees stretching over the hills. That's where the story begins. There the little fir tree was planted, but planted carelessly, so that when the wind blew strong, it fell sideways onto its neighbour and had no chance to grow. The years went by until one December, when the foresters dug up trees for the Christmas market, the little fir tree, stunted and still tangled with its neighbour, was loaded onto a trailer and driven down the motorway to the city. "Oh my," it said breathlessly, for it was at the bottom of the pile. The tallest tree was unroped and taken away, one to stand proudly in a cathedral, another in the middle of a large square, and a third to decorate the stage at a grand Christmas ball. But most of the trees were brought by ordinary folk, for houses where there were children who covered them with stars and silver tinsel, chocolate mice and small secret parcels. The little fir tree and its companion were taken to a large store, where late on Christmas Eve they were the only trees left unsold. A shopper hurried in to make a last-minute purchase. "You'll not want this weedy thing, miss," said the shop assistant as he pulled the little fir tree from the roots of the bigger tree and threw it on one side. The customer smiled and went off, pleased with her buy, but the little fir tree felt fearful of what its fate might be. There was a boy in the shop, drawn in from the rain outside by the warmth and the lights and the wonderful spicy smell of Christmas. He said, "You're throwing that away. Could I have it?" The assistant looked at the little fir tree, hardly what you'd call a tree at all, he shrugged, and handed it over. After all, it was Christmas Eve and the store would soon be closing. The boy went outside into the cheerless evening. He held the little fir tree carefully in front of him so that none of its few crooked branches would get snapped off by shoppers on the pavement. He set off on the long walk to the river. On his way, he found a cardboard box in a little bin and took it along too. When he came to the river, the tide was out and down the steps a small pebbly beach was showing. The boy climbed down and, digging the mud with his hands, he planted the little fir tree in the cardboard box. Near the steps, under the arches of a railway bridge, the boy had another cardboard box, big enough to sleep in. He put the tree on the pavement in front of him. "What a poor thing I am," thought the little fir tree. But the boy seemed pleased, so the little fir tree felt more cheerful. "I belong to someone now," it said to himself, and it began to feel like Christmas. Passerby dropped a coin into the boy's lap. It was enough to buy him supper, but instead he crossed over to the newsagent and brought some candles and a box of matches. He fixed the candles to the branches of the little fir tree. Now other people were returning to claim their cardboard boxes for the night. They gathered round the boy and the little fir tree, and an old busker was an accordion, sat down, and soon the notes of a Christmas song blended with the heavy rumble of the trains overhead. Everyone started to sing. More people gathered, home-going travellers, theatre-goers, sightseers. A policeman tried to move them on, but they stood where they were. The singing people and the traffic was brought to a halt. The candles burned steadily, and the old man played, and still the people sang. The little fir tree felt it would burst with happiness, for it was obvious the boy had forgotten that tonight he would be sleeping in a cardboard box under the railway arch, and that tomorrow he would eat more, not turkey, but soup in a soup kitchen, if he was lucky. The magic of Christmas Eve was everywhere. A few days later, the boy moved on. "You're more dead than alive," he said sadly to the little fir tree as he went, and the tree, feeling dry and brittle, had to agree. But while other Christmas trees were piled into January bonfires, the little fir tree was put in a road sweeper's barrow. "There's a green shoot here," said the road sweeper, looking at the tree's roots, and slyly he planted it in the corner of the park gardens. "There you will find it, not so little now, for against all odds it grew, if not big and tall, at least cheerfully stout. Now it stretches out its branches for sparrows, pigeons, babies, in prams, lovers and office workers. mice nibble its roots. And as the winter days shorten, the fir tree dreams of its poor beginnings in the hills, of that magical Christmas Eve, and of sunny days in the park. Who would have thought, it says to itself, as it looks forward to another spring. Thank you for joining me, and I do hope you join me again for another story. Until then, see you soon. Bye.